Good evening, and thank you for being here to share my moment of meditation at this special time of day, Vespers time, which the poet T.S. Eliot described as the violet hour, when the human heart is like a taxi waiting, throbbing, waiting for the fading of the light, of course. I'll try to keep my meditations witty under the heading of Thank God for Coffee. That is a menu I found in a Grand Café in Salzburg, where else? And it starts really my meditation with a question. Isn't it a pity in some ways that early music is full of sacred monsters, figures like Bach, who fill us with awe and delight, semi-divine, really. They're intimidating and rather scary for the younger generations. This solemn image seems to me not to do justice to the complexity of the picture. The sacred monsters were very much also secular players, active citizens of towns and communities, perfectly capable of getting involved in the social discussions of the days. And it is this provocative, socially oriented aspect of early music that fascinates me and that I'll try to meditate upon with your indulgence, of course. Pertinent example. Well, it goes. It always does what it wants. The Coffee Cantata of Bach. Let's listen. One of the worldly cantatas, in which, of course, the great master also experiments with the new style galant of the days, but the theme actually invites, witty and comic as it may be, it invites a serious exploration of the role of stimulants, of social drugs like coffee, and the emancipation of women in the 17th and 18th century societies of Northern Europe. Approaching the topic this way should change the image of sacred monsters like Bach, actually considering his role as a feminist in the gender wars of the time. The cultural life in Leipzig in 1723, when Bach went to live there, was absolutely caught in a very antagonistic public debate about the role of women in public life. Believe it or not, coffee was part of the controversy. Drinking coffee was equated with being intellectually stimulated, erotically aroused, socially active, and on a par with men. This position was upheld by the emancipated and aristocratic intellectual Marianne von Ziegler, who was a cultural force in the Leipzig of the day. And Ziegler employed artists like Bach and ran a successful but controversial salon where she served coffee every day at 5 o'clock to men and women, married and unmarried, who played music and played cards and debated cultural matters. This was their own way of doing an even talk, not bad. Bach was a frequent guest at the salon, not a regular, but he was reported to being very fond of coffee himself. In 1704, the Leipzig municipal authorities had forbidden women to enter a coffee house, either to work or to consume coffee in public. It was okay to do so in private. So the campaigns to allow women for some basic form of emancipation or refuse it were in full swing. female emancipation and intelligent, witty companionship between men and women were dubious virtues in the eyes of a strict Lutheran society who tended to associate intellectual activity with sexual permissiveness, libertine behavior that would not be suitable to good Christian German women, and certainly not entitled them to consider themselves the equal of men. So should women be allowed to drink coffee really meant should they be allowed to study, to read, to publish in their own name, to be initiated into guilds and learning societies? Should unmarried men and women be allowed to gather together in the salons that were at the time being imported from France and constituted the new standard of civilized behavior in Europe? The fact, by the way, that both coffee and salons were imported from abroad made them doubly suspicious to the local intellectual establishment committed to upholding German cultural superiority. So the public debate on the competence and the morality of learned women was somewhat vehicled by the coffee controversy. Bach's cantata is not unique, but rather belongs to a tradition of experimental and progressive socially oriented music that should appeal to all of us across the ages. I'll give you quickly two other examples with small musical citation. Bernier. Anymore, whatever he does. Thank you. Marraine Marais, favorite of Jordi Savall's. Abrupt, but there you go. Coffee itself arrived in Northern Europe, including Leipzig, around 1665, when the Turkish ambassador visited the Austrian emperor in Vienna to establish an embassy and served it for the first time. The extravagant and expensive beverage became the new fashionable stimulant. It was the ecstasy of the day, and raged across the royal courts and also across society. In Germany, the beer halls were converted into coffee houses, and coffee began to replace alcoholic beverages and tobacco as a public stimulant. There was, of course, a heated public debate about the dangers coffee represented to one's health, both physical and mental, and more particularly to the reproductive powers of women. Allegedly, coffee increased infertility by overstimulating the brain. The fact that other stimulants or drugs, notably tobacco, went so well together with coffee intensified the anxiety about the effects they may have upon the frail nervous systems of women, and also upon women's morals, given that these foreign imports were associated with sexual permissiveness and immorality. To a certain extent, drinking coffee and having a decent marriage were presented as mutually exclusive. So there was a fear of escalation from coffee to tobacco to other mind-altering substances. On the aftermath of European colonial expansion, public debates and musical interventions for and against stimulants or drugs involved also chocolate and tobacco, which had already quite an established history in musical performances. I will not play the music, but this is an example. This is Charpentier, and his great concern is chocolate. Then we have Tobias Hume, and his concern is tobacco, and a famous anonymous also on tobacco. There was, I must say, some reason for the conservatives to worry. It is not all just anxiety of influence and paranoia. There was reason to worry, considering the extent of the 17th century feminist wave. In Britain, Mary Astell wrote in 1694 the serious proposal to the ladies for the advancement of their true and greatest interest. She used rational arguments to defend women's right to education. She recommended all women colleges and strongly advised women to please never marry anybody they were truly in love with. That's a very silly thing to do. Just marry a good companion that you can get on with, because passion always fades and good companionship is what really matters, classical 17th century rationalism. In France, Poulain de la Barre, René Descartes' brightest student, and by the way, a great influence for Simone de Beauvoir centuries later, wrote in 1673 Traité de l'égalité des deux sexes, one of the very first male feminist treatises. Queen Christine of Sweden, also a student of Descartes, was one of the most educated feminists of the days. Interested in religion, philosophy, mathematics, and alchemy, she attracted anybody she could get hold of, including René Descartes, to Stockholm, wanting to make it the Athens of the North. She rejected the sexual role of a woman, caused a scandal when she announced that, just like Queen Elizabeth I, she would not marry. In 1654, she abdicated, converted to Roman Catholicism, traveling to Rome for her baptism. And along the way, Her Royal Highness Queen Christina stopped over in Utrecht to say hello to a very good friend and a major figure in feminism, Anna Maria van Schuurman, the greatest woman intellectual of the Dutch Republic, graduated in 1636 as the first female student of the glorious University of Utrecht. As women at the time were not permitted to study at the university, she had to attend lectures hidden behind a screen so that male students could not see her and would not be perturbed, their fragile brains would not be perturbed by her presence. Anna Maria was not only known for her learning, but also for producing engravings and paintings, and she was admitted to the Guild of Painters in 1643. An extraordinary woman, later converted to an extremist Christian sect and kind of disappeared. Much later, with the French revolutions, ideas of equality became widely accepted. And the towering work of Mary Wollstonecraft in 1792, a vindication of the rights of women, set the agenda for centuries to come. But that was later. The early half of the 17th century saw the development of contradictory trends. Some social forces allowed more freedom of expression to women, but in general, emancipationists were in danger of being suspected of lunacy, of witchcraft, and even of being burned at the stake for heresy. While women of the upper class intelligentsia were granted salon membership and could become artists and intellectuals at home, they were strongly advised to stay in the background of public life. From the emancipatory point of view, the 17th century was a mixture of rebellion and restoration. Bach's coffee cantata, originally performed in a big Leipzig coffee house, was very much part of an effort to both reflect, pacify, and contain the gender wars. Bach mediates the struggle between the conservatives and the radical positions by making sort of fun of it in a slightly opportunistic manner, because he's also very threatened by this new style of music that is coming up. He's afraid of losing the market. So he's trying to find compromises to strike a moderate consensus while experimenting with new musical forms. So this is not only the work of a sacred monster, but a secular intervention in a controversial and potentially explosive social issue, which Bach confronts with innovation and wit. So we should let it known, wide and large, that Bach and early music with him is not an ossified museum moment, but very vibrant cultural phenomenon that continues to resonate across the age for us. For listeners of all ages, early music is forever young in defending the right to freedom, freedom of expression, freedom of rebellion, freedom of consumption of coffee, tobacco, and other mind-altering drugs. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, early music rocks.